Markets, Maxwell's, Alewife, Jordan's. I hope I haven't missed any farm markets. When I first ran for this office, I asked one of the farmers how we could best support farms, and he said, just by buying your vegetables from us all summer long. So I would encourage all our town residents to do what they can to support the local farms, and in turn, you'll get great produce. So that's my first annual thing that I do. And then secondly, it's that time of the year when many of us have to leave our young adults home alone. And I would just remind people as they go away on vacation, our police department is more than willing. First of all, everyone who goes away should know that our police department is more than willing to, you know, sort of drive by. You ought to let them know that you're away. And especially if you are leaving young adults home alone, the police department is more than willing to drive by and make sure that nothing happens to your house or that no parties occur. So I would encourage people to stop by dispatch or give a call if you find yourself in that situation. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other reports or correspondence? I would just like to mention that I, along with Councilor Fritz and our town manager, attended a very nice luncheon celebrating the the renaming of Regional Waste Systems to EcoMaine. It's quite an impressive operation they have out there, and it is a great regional effort that many towns in Cumberland County work together on to get rid of trash. And it is one of the single biggest budget items in the Cape Elizabeth budget. And I just want to say I think Kevin Roche, who is the relatively new manager out there, is doing a great job. And I want to thank our town manager and Councilor Fritz for serving as our representatives on EcoMaine's board. So thank you. And I also
trash and recycling.
Trash and recycling. Thank you. I'm sorry. Thank you. I stand correct. Our expert on trash and recycling has reminded me. I also attended the Council of Governments annual meeting and was pleased that Paul McKinney was elected as second vice president of the Council of Governments. So that's another thing where Cape Elizabeth has good representation, and where Cape citizens are serving the greater community beyond Cape Elizabeth's borders. So thank you. Okay, next, do we have any other reports or correspondence?
No.
No? Next, the town manager's report.
Thank you, Ann. A couple of quick issues. First, Mary Ann mentioned farm stands. Jim and Evelyn Cox, I don't know if they have one this year, but sometimes they have a small stand up there as well, in addition to the more established ones that you mentioned. Secondly, we had a very successful family fun day. I want to thank Steve Culver, the chairman of it. Councilor Moles was very heavily involved as well. Some Frank Butterworth, some of the different folks from the Lions Club were extremely active, and there was a wonderful fireworks show and a lot of different activities. And I want to thank Steve and Michael and the rest of the group who helped to put that day on. It's a fine tradition, and from all accounts, it went well. I was only there for the very end of it, but I heard great reports on the day. Secondly, I want to mention that the library had an excellent celebration as well last Saturday on their 20th anniversary. And one really good turnout, 300 to 400 apparently. I didn't count them, but that's what they told me today. But it was lots of different, particularly great activities for young kids. And if you have a chance, there's a beautiful display over there at the Preservation Society in the library put together of old pictures of the library and of the property. It's just a fascinating display. And if you have a chance to go over in the next month or so and look at that, that would be great. And third, I just want to congratulate Deborah Cabana on her appointment as the town manager of Gray, Maine. She is actually on a little bit of vacation right now, but she'll be beginning work there soon. And I look forward to having her as a peer in the profession. And in the meantime, I want to thank her, and I want to thank all those that are helping out in the process. The next agenda item of the first one, you'll be considering the approval of the appointment of a deputy town clerk and registrar of voters, apparently. And, but, and Jack will be helping, I know Deborah's going to be helping out, and Terry Olson, and Debbie Bump, and everyone else, and I appreciate everyone's assistance as we go through this process, so, thank you.
Okay, thank you. It is now the first of our two periods for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. If there's any citizen who would like to speak, please come forward to the podium and state your name and address. Seeing no one, we will move on to our first item, which is item number 121-2006. Has to do with our acting town clerk. Mike, would you like to introduce this?
Yes. Under the municipal charter, the town manager appoints the different department heads subject to the approval of the town council. I'm very happy that Jackie Coy has agreed to be the town clerk until we find a new one. And I know she'll do a fine job. And we have a local Cape Elizabeth Association of former town clerks, both of whom have advised me this evening that I probably should appoint a registrar of voters as well to serve until we find a new town clerk, just to ensure that that position's carried forward a while. So I'd also like to appoint Jackie as the registrar of voters and ask for the council's approval of the appointment of my appointment of town clerk, and ask you to you actually appoint the registrar of voters. I don't, so that would be your appointment.
Okay, thank you, Mike. Do I hear a motion?
I would move ratification or approval of the town manager's appointment of Jacqueline N. Coy as acting town clerk, and I would further move her appointment as registrar of voters.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there discussion? Okay, all in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much, Jackie. Good to have you back here, if only for a short time. Thank you for pitching in. Our next item is item number 122-2006, having to do with the Spurwink Church Study Committee report. With Deborah Lane, our assistant town manager, like to come forward.
Good evening. Thank you. On behalf of the Spurwink Church Study Committee, we are pleased this evening to provide you with our final report. The members of the committee have been working for a year now on looking at the capital needs of the church. At this time, I wanted to take a minute to recognize and thank the members of the committee, some of which are here this evening. Elizabeth Peterson and Jane Beckwith are with us. Thank you, ladies. Ernie McVane, who also serves as our facilities manager, served as staff with me. Councillor Fritz served on the committee, as well Councillor McKinney. Co-chairmen were Darren McClellan and Bruce Munger, and Dan Chase also served. I apologize, the other members are not here with summer schedules. It was hard, and I'm sorry, Ann Strout as well, and she could not be here. So again, I want to acknowledge and thank those committee members. The committee really did some fine work, and I think that you will see that in the report. It was interesting when we got to know each other on the committee, we found that we had different interests. Some had more of an engineering interest of the building itself, some more of the historical aspect. But with that, through the year, everything came together, and I think that that's why you have such a comprehensive report, is that everyone worked together but with different interests, so it was really very interesting, and we really all enjoyed working together. The impetus, I guess, for this was an engineer's report back in 2003, November 2003. It's by Pinkham and Greer, and you folks have that engineering report. Back then, Ernie and Michael had discussed that in the somewhat near future, probably, some capital needs of the church would have to be addressed. So it was really with that document that the committee moved forward. We added to that report, we had some other reports done, some elevation reports, and along with that, we added the historical perspective. We worked with a preservation consultant, and that was extremely helpful in trying to, again, tie in the engineering needs and the historical perspective. From the first meeting, it was interesting that it was unanimous throughout the committee that they did not want to change the face of the church. that they wanted to preserve, conserve, all these terms that we learned over the last year, that facility really as it is. So in the report, you don't see any major changes in terms of what the facility will look like, which I think everybody will be pleased with. There is a cover letter that was included in your packet written by the co-chairman, Bruce and Darren, and basically it gives you a quick synopsis of what the major recommendations are. If you read the cover letter and perhaps the executive summary, you'll really get a sense of the work that we did in the last year. The executive summary goes into a little bit more detail and also gives a methodology that we use to come up with the recommendations. Assumably tonight you folks will vote to send us to workshop, in which I will give the council and the church members an opportunity to really go into detail into this report. You will see that there are a lot of attachments in your report. The committee felt it important not only for you to make your decisions and move ahead, but in the future for folks to look back to see what work was done, what information is available. We found some of the information a little sketchy when trying to find out what was done on the church and when. So we felt that this was an important opportunity to gather as much information as that we could. Also, we have recommended that some monies be put in the budget for historical, pictorial, and written documentation of what is done on this project, again, for future reference for folks looking back. So we think that that was an important element, something that we learned very early on that was important. In the, and I'm not going to go into great detail, in the major recommendations, basically the first one is the foundation and stabilization. It is very apparent that the foundation needs to be shored up. We had some elevation studies that showed that maybe in one corner is a little lower than another. We did not do test pits to see exactly what the timbers and so forth look like underneath. We're hoping that we're in pretty good shape in regards to that, but the foundation does need to be replaced. On the Route 77 side, you'll notice that the sill at the actual building is touching, is in contact with the ground, so there's a lot of rot there, and we need to see some drainage work to have the drainage go away from the building. So between that work and the replacement of the foundation, we really feel that things will be in good shape. The other thing important about the foundation is we'd like to see the facade of the rubble, the veneer laid, I think that they call it, that remain the same. So again, the look will remain the same, but what's within that, the foundation, will probably be of a new material. The other thing that the committee talked about a lot was the clapboards and the painting. You'll notice that there's a lot of work that needs to be done on that, and then the rough carpentry around the detail of the windows and so forth. Again, we want to keep as much of the look of the church that it has now, and many of it is, you know, years and years of weathered, so we didn't, or we have not recommended that we totally take off the clapboards and replace with new. We feel it's important to scrape and replace when necessary, so again, it'll still kind of have that old feel, but so that was a real major consideration that the committee took a lot of time looking at. In terms of the funding, we're looking for or recommending a fundraising committee because there are not the funds in hand as of right now to do this capital needs for the church. We are looking at about a $260,000 project, again, for the foundation stabilization, as we call it, the drainage, and the painting and some other minor issues. Beyond that, there is a recommended endowment fund. It's suggested of $225,000. Again, these monies would set, and then over time, we would be able to use it for other capital needs, the roof and painting and new furnace as it comes up within about the next 20 years or so. Again, you'll see all that detail in the report. With that, I'm going to leave it at that. As I say, once you get into the report, I'm sure you've looked at different sections of it. The committee looks forward to workshopping this with you and seeing as you go forward. And as I say, the big piece really, I think, is the fundraising. One nice thing that we found out is that there are no life safety issues at this point right now, that it doesn't have to be done tomorrow, but it is something that should be on the fairly recent horizon. So we look forward to working with you folks on this project. So.
Great, thank you. We will, I presume, be sending this to workshop, but if there are any questions that you need an immediate answer to at this moment, this is your chance. Great. I think we're all set. We will leave it for workshop. Do I hear a motion?
I'll move that we receive and accept the report and have the report done at a soon-to-be-set workshop.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
And moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
I'd just like to, as a member of the committee, I'd really like to thank the staff, Ernie McBain and Deborah Lane, for all the help that you gave us. And I think we really did have a very good committee that did a lot of very serious work. And just to mention one other thing, we're recommending another committee be set up to actually have the charge of doing the fundraising and planning for it in more detail.
Okay, that's good to know. And I would like to add my thanks to the citizen volunteers who worked on this committee, Jane Beckwith, Dan Chase, Carolyn Fritz, who was on the council, Paul McKinney on the council, the two chairs, Darren McClellan, Bruce Munger, also Elizabeth Peterson and Ann Strout, and then also, the staff and folks, Deborah Lane and Ernie McVeigh, who worked on this. Thank you. It's a great example of the citizen volunteership in this town that makes this town work, and we really appreciate your help very much. So I hear a motion, and I've heard a second. Any further discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. And I presume perhaps at the end of this meeting we can handle the scheduling of the workshop just to get our calendars out.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deborah. Thank you very much. That brings us to our next item, which is item number 123-2006, which has to do with wastewater submeters. Would the manager like to introduce this?
I would very briefly, because at the end of my very brief comments, I'm going to suggest that this be tabled to a future council meeting. The water district is going through a process of trying to retrofit its meters and submeters. The submeters measure the water usage that is going into the house but is not, but is then going outside the house. It measures the outside water usage. They're concerned, the water district have been meeting with other towns, and we were invited to a meeting, but you see in the notes, it came at a time when we couldn't go. They're looking at how is this going to be paid for, since the submeters are owned privately and not as the meters are owned by the water district, how would this expense be borne? In speaking with the district, it's a little bit unclear as to the exact cost, because on the one hand, they're saying it's a $150 cost, and the other hand, they're saying it could be retrofitted cheaper. And when I asked them about that, they said, well, the real cost is in all of the customer service for all of the calls that these submeters generate, and the fact that they need a whole separate system of meter reading, they need two meter readings, and they just get an awful lot of phone calls. And they're looking really to recover the operating expense of that as well as the capital cost. I am not, and the more I've spoken to them, and Mary Ann called me with some questions, I still would like to have a little more information on this before I'd ask you to vote on it. And I'd be happy to try to answer any questions, but some of it remains a little fuzzy. So, but I think it's important that folks know that the issue needs to be considered, and it is something that you'll be getting at some point. And as you can see, the district's asking, will be asking us to make a commitment over the next few months.
Since the manager has recommended tabling, and since if anyone makes a tabling motion, there is no discussion, I'd like to ask if anyone has any questions or comments for the manager. Let's do it before we make a motion. Councillor Fritz.
I was basically wondering whether this proposed charge, as it is right at the moment, of $2 a month, would be only charged to people who have this meter that separates and measures differently when they're watering their lawn and what goes into the sewer. and that people who are on septic systems would not be charged that, and people who do not have a meter would not be charged that. It would only be those who have the separation meter.
You are correct. Only those with a sub-meter who are on sewer.
Okay. Councilor Lynch, did you have a question?
No, I just wanted to thank the manager. We've had a conversation about it, and just briefly, to the extent that this is a charge for the Portland Water District answering questions when people call for their bills as opposed to hardware, I think we need to resolve that and then make sure that we're charging or not charging as is appropriate. So I support his request that we table it, because I do think we need to get a little more information about what it is we're asking people to pay for, particularly in light of what I recall to be a kind of substantial increase in the sewer bills that we put forth last spring, and then this would be on top of that to that same subgroup of people. So I support the tabling motion.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Frank?
I guess just one other thing. I mean, in part of the explanation, it sounded as though it was going to be a remote metering system that might be similar to the water meter is read now, which seems to me is easier for them. In the end, they'll have less man hours going around reading meters, or it'll be easier, so it seems like they could recoup that cost. So I don't know. It didn't seem like a necessary charge to me, but I guess I'd like more details.
I think the manager will make sure that we have more complete information. Any questions from this side of the dais? Okay. Mr. Manager, did you want to table this to a specific meeting or just indefinitely?
Indefinitely, and then with the understanding they'll bring back when the district provides the information.
Okay.
Without prejudice to bringing it back in the same council.
Yes. Really.
Councilor Lynch?
Mike, the only question I had with an indefinite postponement was what seemed to be a little bit of a veiled threat from the Portland Water District that if we don't adopt this, I forget the language they use.
Then the people
won't says by September 1st.
Then the customers will not be able to receive a wastewater adjustment, which I suppose to the extent that people did receive that adjustment, I would hope that we could bring it up in the August meeting and have it resolved, because I'd hate to forego the adjustment that people rightfully get, because they're not putting water into the sewer system.
Is that okay with you, Mike?
Yeah. I will make sure I bring it back in time. That doesn't happen. One reason why, I really didn't know if this was ready. I presumed there'd be lots of questions, and I saw the September 1 deadline, and I wanted to give us a chance for me to hear the questions and to return to it. So, I read that September 1, and I don't think they're as ready as they claim they are. So.
Okay.
We can always table it again in August if we have to.
If you want to do it, however you want.
I would rather do it that way.
Would you like to make a motion, Councilor?
I would move that we table it until the August meeting.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to table this to the August Town Council meeting. There is no discussion allowable on tabling motions. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Mike. We'll just look forward to more information on this.
Exciting.
You don't sound sincere, Mike. Okay. That brings us to item number 124-2006, which has to do with accepting a grant. Mike?
Yes, the fire chief applied through the Rural Fire Assistance Grant Program of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for a grant for the new radios that are actually going to be going on to the new fire truck that we got from a grant through Homeland Security. And the good news is they agreed to fund the grant, provided we have a local match of $630. We had provided not only the local match funds, but we had provided the monies for all the radios in the upcoming year's budget. So this would, be a help savings grant. So I would encourage you to accept the $5,670 grant.
And who was it that wrote for the grant or applied for the grant?
The fire chief.
The fire chief?
Chief McGoldrick.
Okay, thank you to the chief. Is there anyone who would like to make a motion, please?
I'll move that we accept the $5,670 grant from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the required local match of $630.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Are there any questions? All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. And please convey our thanks to the chief. Okay, next. Item number 125-2006, having to do with acceptance of deed and easements. Mike?
Yeah, you have a list here, proposed deeds and easements to be accepted. These all came about as a result of the engineering that went on for the sewer project, for the proposed sewer project, and the ultimate survey work. OST did an awful lot of work on this, Steve Harding and Danny Bolander, the prime surveyor, and then Bob Malley, God bless him, went and actually spoke to each of these residents, and it was actually a lot of time, you know, going back and forth with different questions and different issues, and he arranged it so that they all were willing at no cost to the town for the easement itself. We had some little bit of legal expense and survey expense, but at no expense to the town. These individuals have granted different easements. A couple of them are for the cross-country section down just up this side of Lions Field. There's one that goes from Longfellow Drive from the Canes down to the cross sewer, the sewer pipe that runs across by the marsh there. The Flaherty's down on Running Tide Road. It's the connecting piece that goes down to the cul-de-sac there, that piece. The Wiskowskis and Janet McKay, we actually discovered that Geldart Lane, the little street that's off Wood Road, was in part on their property. The road was not in the town right of way. And Janet McKay and the Wiskowskis were very generous to work with us and to actually deed over to the town the land that the road was sitting on that was part of their personal property. So. We really appreciate all of the contributions these are from these different residents of Cape Elizabeth. There's also temporary construction here, one Village Crossing as well. And, you know, I want to really express appreciation to Bob Malley and to Steve Harding and Danny Bolander and the other folks that were involved in this process.
Great. I, too, would like to add the thanks of the council to the staff, people who worked on this, but most especially to the members of the public, the citizens who very generously provided these easements. Is there a motion?
I would move to accept the deeds and easements as more fully set out in our package with the deep appreciation of the council.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any questions or discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. That brings us to item number 126-2006, having to do with proposed carry-forward budget balances. Would the manager like to speak to this?
Each July, I bring forward to you what ends up being the designated fund balance that's in the June 30, 2005 report. These different amounts are the proposed designated fund balances, and they range from the Spurwink Avenue Improvements Match, something we all hope will get done sometime soon, probably in the spring, that's $208,740, down to $1,511 for a federal fire prevention materials grant monies that we have. It also includes a new thing that needed to be drawn out. It's an estimate of the retroactivity cost when the police contract gets resolved. And that's the cost of both the police and the dispatch.
Okay.
And I'd be happy to answer any questions you have on any of these items.
And I see a note that these total to $847,363, and that library gifts are also carried forward?
That's correct.
In excess, I mean, beyond that amount?
That's right.
Okay. Okay, is there a motion?
I'll make a motion that we accept the proposed carry-forward balances as set forth in the town council agenda, totaling $847,363.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second? Okay. Do we have to add to the motion about the library gifts?
I assume the clerk, the acting clerk.
We'll assume that you're also...
It was as set forward in the...
Yes, okay, thank you.
In the agenda.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Any questions? Councilor Fritz?
I just had a comment. I will vote affirmatively for this, because there's a lot of important things in here, with the exception of the $70,000 for the traffic light on Shore Road.
So noted.
Wait, are you asking that we set that?
No.
No, she said she will be voting.
Okay.
She's just making an editorial comment.
I'm supporting that item on the list.
She doesn't like that one. Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor? It's unanimous. Okay. That brings us to item number 127-2006, which has to do with the request for a zoning text amendment. Do you want to introduce this, Mike?
I'd be happy to. You actually have a letter on the podium here this evening on the dais from Andy and Kelly Stroud of Shady something. I forget the name of the... It was on the envelope. It isn't on the letter.
Shady Brook Farm.
Shady Brook Farm? Shady Oak Farm? Anyway...
Shady something.
They board horses. They train horses. They do a number of other things there. And Bruce Smith actually saw the sign on the side of their pickup truck and wondered if all of the things that they're doing in that RA zone are actually allowed within that zone. And it's his feeling that, everyone has good intentions, but, you know, maybe they aren't all permitted within that zone. So what I'd like to do is speak to the Strouts who own this property. And we know of at least three others in town who also are in similar type of business activities. And, you know, we'd like to look at it and give the council an opportunity to determine if these are all clearly permitted uses, and, you know, to ensure these, you know, rural, farm, family-friendly activities to have a chance to operate within the ordinances of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Okay. So your recommendation is to refer the request to the planning board?
Yeah, and we're going to help with some drafting. We don't actually have language. And we also, while you may have seen Bruce sent a letter, you know, we're not doing any enforcement activity other than the initial letter, waiting to see the policy direction from the board and the council.
Okay.
So they may continue.
They may continue.
Yes, just business as usual for the time being. Is there a motion?
I'll move that we request the planning board review the zoning ordinance in regards to the care, training, and boarding of horses in larger residential zones.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Councilor Lynch?
I tend to disagree with the code enforcement officer on the interpretation of this, but I think more importantly, as I listen to the manager, if we're looking at this generically for four farms, it doesn't strike me as fair that one person has to pay the $100, and I would suggest if it's a generic look at this issue, then we should do it without charging one farmer who we've sort of made to request this, and we've put that farm, and it's a horse farm as far as I can tell. So I support it, and I will vote for the motion, but...
I will accept that as a friendly amendment.
I don't think we should be charging or expecting someone who has been put in the position of being told they need to be an applicant, and now we're looking at this generically for four farms to bear the cost.
I would like to suggest, if you choose to do that, that you refund $100 to the Strouts, that you not waive the fee, because the waiver is a requirement of the zoning ordinance, and
okay,
I'm not sure you're allowed to waive the zoning ordinance.
Okay. Well, then I would suggest the amendment be to refund the fee in light of the fact that we are looking at it generically for four farms.
And I thank the Strouts for having put forward the initial $100 and accept the amendment to refund their fee.
Okay. And you were the second. So we've got the motioner and the second in agreement. Any other questions or comments?
Yes.
Councilor Dill?
Well, as much as I appreciate the willingness of Councilor Lynch to amend the motion to refund the Strouts $100, I guess my take on it is that, in fact, the code enforcement officer has found a violation of the zoning ordinance, and we're going to undertake the initiative to amend the zoning ordinance, that rather than refund the $100, that we perhaps ask the other non-conforming businesses to pay $100. I just don't know if as much as I support family farms and businesses, I do think that when we're asking, I think everybody needs to pay their fair share of the costs, and this is going to be an expensive endeavor, I think, to change the zoning ordinance to the extent that people are going to get together. And so that would be my friendly amendment, is to just, rather than give a refund, to just fairly charge everyone the same.
I'll accept that. I'll understand that as another motion. Is there to amend the original motion, is there a second for Councillor Dill's idea of charging all four farms the $100 fee? Is there a second for that? I'm not hearing a second for that, so that amendment to the motion fails for lack of a second, which brings us, yes, Councilor Knowles.
I would just like to say that I think Councilor Dill is very well-intended. We're very tightly watching our budget, and I applaud her for bringing that mention forward, but that we should still, you know, stay where we are. It doesn't really cost us that much money to go through this process with the planning board.
Okay. So the motion is to refer this to the planning board, and then after we receive the check from the Strouts, to refund the $100 fee to the Strouts.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify that the code enforcement officer has not found the other three properties in violation. No such determination has been made. In two of them, in fact, I know did go to the zoning board at one point and got certain approvals. So, you know, but we just want to be sure that as long as we're dealing with one, we're dealing with all four. So, you know, he has made a judgment on the one on the Shady Oak Farm, but no determination has been made on the other three. So I wouldn't want it reported by the forecaster in the Century that the other three are in violation, because they're not.
And
Councilor Lynch.
I just think that it is debatable. I understand that the code enforcement officer made a finding of non-conforming use, but I looked at the zoning ordinance today, and the zoning ordinance permits farms, it permits livestock, and so I think it's debatable whether or not boarding horses in a barn is a non-conforming use when, in fact, what you have is a farm that has livestock, and it happens to be livestock owned by other people. So I just think it's not clear. I respect the hard work of the code enforcement officer in enforcing the issue, and I think we should resolve it, but I think it's really debatable whether there's a violation here, but I'm willing to vote to try and resolve it.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Moles.
I would also like to say that I agree with Councilor Lynch that I really don't see a violation of the ordinance there, but we are requesting the planning board just kind of to clear it up for us.
Right. I would agree that I think our proposed motion here, if passed, which I assume it's going to pass, is a good resolution. I think it will ensure that the Strouts don't bear the total brunt of this and that the ordinance is straightened out so that it works well for all agricultural farms in the town. Council Fritz?
I guess I'm just wondering if we're going to just allow the Strouts to continue, which I think we should do, and we're going to look at it generically, then should we be consistent and instead of sending an proposed amendment to the planning board, we had a previous amendment that was proposed and we sent it to the Comprehensive Planning Committee. I think we should be consistent here. I mean, I was in favor of that particular amendment following the rules of how you amend the ordinances by sending it to the planning board, but that one went to the Comprehensive Planning Committee and was delayed, say, a year and a half or something. So.
That's a point, Mike?
Yeah, I had a very pointed conversation with the town planner, who is out straight with all of the business that's already before the planning board, the Comprehensive Planning Committee, a number of other committees she's working with. And I agreed that I would take the leadership on this issue rather than having another issue dumped onto the planner at this point. And I would do the meeting with the residences and the research and whatever. You know, that it can go to the Comprehensive Plan Committee, but it you know, I just don't want to put it back on Maureen as the staff person. And I know she's the staff person for the planning board as well. However, in this instance, I'm going to try to get most of the work done in the drafting done in the analysis of how it affects and meeting with all these folks. And it's just it's easier not to have it to the comp plan committee for that reason.
Councilor Lynch.
I agree it shouldn't go. I don't think it should go also for the reason that we have a finding of a violation of a particular provision of the zoning ordinance, and so that needs to be resolved. And the Comprehensive Planning Commission is going to issue a report next April, but there will not be any actions taken by the council until well into late 07. So we'd be a year and a half away from resolving a finding of a non-conforming use. So I think given the particular situation, Michael's right that it should not go to the comprehensive plan. It's not to say they can't look at agriculture, and I know they have already, but.
Well, as a member of the comprehensive plan, I can assure Councillor Fritz that this is now going into my file of issues that will be considered by the comprehensive plan. So I have a feeling the two things will work in parallel. I don't think that this is a controversial enough issue that it's going to be a problem for the comprehensive plan, but I will guarantee you that this will be dealt with at our meetings. So,
but the particular issue of formula restaurants was something that the Comprehensive Planning Committee had already dealt with the business districts, and it was kind of dumped there as well, and I think it needs some action.
So
that's on a different subject, but.
Are you proposing that we should not be sending this to the planning board, that instead we should be sending, to be consistent, we should be sending it to the comprehensive plan committee?
That's basically what I'm saying, yeah.
Okay.
I would rather be consistent and bring the other one back out of the committee, but.
So we have to vote on Michael Mull's motion first, I think procedurally, and then if his fails, then.
Well, I think we've got some further discussion, I think, down here. I heard some throat clearing, so hang on. Councillor Dill.
Actually, I did have an additional comment, but I'm going to hold off at this point. Thank you.
Okay. Any further comments down here? Councillor Fritz, so will you be not supporting this? I just have a question. Will you be not supporting sending this to the planning board since you think it should be sent to the comprehensive plan group? I'm just asking. You don't have to say. I mean, I can wait for you to
think.
Because I'm thinking it through. I'm finding your argument persuasive. I have no problem with the planning board seeing it, but I do think, I've used this argument before on other issues, and I think I have to, intellectually, I have to be honest and consistent, and so I think, therefore, I have to favor sending it to the Comprehensive Plan Committee. As long as I can be sure, in the meantime, that this is not going to screw up the Strouds' lives, but I don't understand that it will. Is that correct, Mike?
Mary Ann Lynch, I think, made an excellent point is, you know, this is, we're dealing with a known violation of something that the code enforcement has interpreted as a violation. It's not like someone wanted to come in and do something different, and I think that raises a higher standard for attempts to address it sooner rather than later. And while I have the floor, I would like to point out that any council action takes at least 4 votes. A 3-2 vote does not pass.
Work tonight.
Well, I could vote to send it to the planning board, but I'd also like to vote. I'd like to amend the motion to also send it to the comprehensive plan. I just want to.
Can I make a suggestion on the comprehensive plan?
Yes.
Since I'm on that committee as well. We, as you know, Ann, have been collecting lots of letters from lots of people, and we're revisiting everything, all the chapters at the end. And so I wonder if it can't just be handled as yet another issue letter the comprehensive plan committee can look at almost sui sponte, that is on their own motion. Mm-hmm. And yet Michael and the planning board can go ahead with resolving Bruce's finding on a faster track.
And that is what I would like to do.
And I think we could do that without a motion referring it, but just treat it as all the other correspondence that's come in.
Well, I don't want to ignore the violation, so I will be supporting sending this to the planning board, but I would like to also formally refer it to the Comprehensive Plan Committee, because it's not a big emergency for the town. It is of an urgent nature for the Strouds, because there's a violation. So it sort of falls betwixt and between. I'm sympathetic to Carol's argument, and for consistency's sake, I would like to see us refer it specifically to the Comprehensive Plan Committee, just to make sure it gets officially on the list of things to be considered. And I know we're doing that, we would do that informally anyways, because you and I are both on the same committee, but I would like to see it formally done. So we can vote on the planning board thing, and then I'll be making a motion that we also just refer it to the Comprehensive Plan Committee for them to consider in the agricultural section. Give you warning of what I'll be doing. Is there another comment down here?
Well, I just wanted to then make my comment that I agree that the issue should be sent to the planning board, and I can agree that it should also be sent to the Comprehensive Plan Committee. I am not going to support the motion if it includes this idea that the town council is going to refund the $100, because I don't think that it's good precedent to substitute our judgment about a code violation for that code enforcement officer. I agree that it's open to different interpretation, but I don't feel that's our role at this point, is to make those decisions. So that's my feeling about it.
Kit, then acting as chair, I would like to suggest that Councillor Moles, pull back his motion, and let's separate this into 3 different motions. One is the motion to send it to the planning board. The second one is the motion to refund the $100. Mm-hmm. The third one would be a motion to send it to the comprehensive plan. And that way we could separate the things. Would that be acceptable to you, Councillor Moles?
Yes.
Thank you. Would you like to make a motion to refer this to the planning board?
I would like to make a motion to refer to the planning board the issue of horse boarding, training, and care.
Okay. Is there a second?
In residential zones.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. I'm hoping there's not a lot of discussion. Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor of referring this to the planning board? 5. It's unanimous. Okay. Would you like to make a second motion, Councillor Moles, on refunding the $100 fee to the Strouds?
I would make a motion that we refund the $100 fee to to the Strouts that they've already paid to the town on this issue.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
Yeah.
Councilor Lynch.
Yes, I would just like to respond to Councilor Dill. I'm not trying to substitute the council's judgment for the code enforcement officer, but I am suggesting that when the town manager says this is more, you know, we're looking at this because there are other farms as well, that if it's a generic issue, we ought not to have one farm pay for it. So I think for that reason, we should refund the $100. It is not a it was not rendered as a penalty, and I would never make a motion to, you know, refund a penalty or substitute our judgment for the code enforcement officer.
Okay. Further discussion? No? All in favor of refunding the $100 fee to the Struts? Four? Opposed? One. Okay. So that one passes. And then I would like to make a motion that we refer this matter for consideration for the Comprehensive Plan Committee to consider in their planning process that they're doing over the coming months. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
All yes, I guess I have. I could support that so long as subsequent planning board action and council action isn't put off for a year and a half as we try to resolve this issue. So I would just hope that the Comprehensive Planning Committee is looking at this in a very generic way, but yes, when the planning board comes back to us in approximately 4 to 6 months, which is about what that will take, but it will be 6 months shorter than the comprehensive plan, that we can resolve this specific issue as it relates to the Strouts.
Yes, and just we will learn in item number 129 that the Comprehensive Plan Committee schedule is being pulled out a little bit, but I think we will get to the a second review of the agriculture section by around Christmas time. So I think the timing will work out. So, and I too do not want to delay any action on the Strouts particular matter for the final report of the Comprehensive Plan Committee. Any further discussion? All in favor of referring it to the Comprehensive Plan Committee? Four. Opposed? One. Okay, great. Thank you. Well, that was a little more complex than they thought. Sometimes these things are surprising. I thought that would be a quick one. Thank you very much. I think it was a good discussion, and I'm glad that I think we came up with a good way of breaking it into the three different components. Okay. Hang on. Just making myself a note here. That brings us to item number 128-2006. It is time to cast the annual ballot for the Maine Municipal Association election officers. I will introduce this one because I'm pretty familiar with it since I'm on the ballot. Every year, the Maine Municipal Association sends ballots to all its member municipalities, or about 500 of them in the state, to vote on the election of officers and directors to serve on the Maine Municipal Association Executive Committee. There's a nominating committee that reviews nominations and interviews people who are interested in serving, either as MMA's vice president or also as people who want to serve on as directors of the Executive Committee. Ballots, those folks have been nominated, and ballots have been mailed out to all the different municipalities around the state. These ballots have to be returned by Friday, August 11th, 2006, and so now we are going to be casting Cape Elizabeth's ballots, and the people who cast the ballots are the legislative body of each one of the towns, and that might be the selectmen for some towns, or it's the town council for this group. On the ballot, nominated for president for a one-year term is Nick Mavadonis, who is a councilor in the city of Portland. He's proposed by the MMA nominating committee. For the vice president, serving a one-year term, nominated by the Maine Municipal Association Nominating Committee, is Ann Swift Kayotta, counselor, Town of Cape Elizabeth. There are also two other candidates who were nominated by petition. What that means is that these were folks who also went through the nominating process but did not emerge as the nominee. However, they have decided, as is their right, to be to solicit support from at least five towns, the elective bodies of five towns. They've gotten them to petition to put them on the ballot. So nominated by petition are two different candidates. One is Ruth Martin, town manager, Town of Jay. The other is Janet White, who is the chair of the selectmen of the town of New Portland. So that is the only contested race on the ballot. And then there are nominees proposed by the nominating committee for three-year terms as directors on the executive committee. We vote for three. There are three nominees: Stephen Bunker, selectman, Town of Farmington; Scott Harriman, town manager, Town of Baileyville; and John Sylvester, selectman, Town of Alfred. And everyone's, all the various nominees, their credentials and short bios, biographical sketches of each candidate is attached. I presume you've had a chance to review them.
Sorry, I didn't mean
I was going to say, is there a motion? Or is there a question? Well, go right ahead. Make
I'll
motion.
Move the Cape Elizabeth Town Council test a vote for Nick Mavridonis and for Ann Swift Kayotta and for the three directors as proposed.
Second.
Is that the correct way to
I think that'll do it.
Thank you. Second.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Okay, the only thing I'll say is I appreciate your support, and I hope I will prevail and be able to serve the state of Maine, the municipalities of the state of Maine in a broader context, but we'll find out in August if I win that race or not. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Appreciate your support. I'll keep you posted. Okay, that brings us to item number 129, 2006, comprehensive plan deadline. Marianne, would you like to say something on this since you're on that committee?
I'm on that committee, but I missed the last meeting.
Oh,
where I think
I'm
this
sorry.
Vote was taken, but
I can deal with it if you want.
I mean, I can just say that we're moving very quickly. We're doing a lot of work. The report is about half done, but it will not be done within the time allotted by the council originally. So the committee apparently in my absence recommended requesting the council extend the deadline to April 2nd, 2007.
Second.
And I moved that.
I'm seconding that because I'm also on the committee and I was at the meeting. So.
And I think they truly do need that. The last public forum is in the November time period, and in order to rewrite the comprehensive plan, you know, expecting public comment, and with the holidays, I think the beginning of April is a reasonable time frame.
Just to clarify, Ann, they recommended February 28th. The manager changed it to the April date, recognizing it
which manager, you?
That was me. That there was
this third person stuff.
Thank
is
you.
Confusing to me.
That's it. I moved it to April 2nd, because it gives time to print it. And these last-minute deadline things don't work. It was too tight a schedule.
Thank you.
They still plan to finish by February 28th. Okay.
Yes. And I will just add, as a member of the committee who was there, that the group is working very hard, as Marianne says, and we're making very good progress. But there's just a lot to the plan, and we want to, you can see from the schedule, this is the last page, we'd want to allow plenty of time. Well, you see dates in October, November, and December for reviewing the complete draft plan, and that's because we're going through the plan section by section, but then things come up that are pertinent to that section after we've reviewed that section, and rather than continually looping back constantly on each section, we're going to go through each section again at the end and loop in all the new issues. And then we also want to have plenty of time for a public forum, not before the holidays, because that was not felt to be a good time. People would be distracted. And then we want to have time to review the public forum comments and make sure there's plenty of opportunity for the public to, to give us their ideas and feedback. So I think Mike has made a good suggestion to allow, we, the committee, will shoot for February 28th, but setting the deadline for April 2nd is a good idea for printing and all the logistical stuff. So are there any questions for Mary Ann or me or the manager on this?
I'll move that we, the town council, grant the comprehensive planning committee's request for an extension of time to April 2nd,
2007. Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further questions or discussion? No? Okay, all in favor? 5. It's unanimous. And I do want to thank Maureen. Maureen O'Meara, our town planner, she is working tirelessly on this project, and she's got a lot of other very important duties that she's handling in the meantime. This is a very, very big project, but she's doing an excellent job of keeping us moving. And Barbara Schenkel and who is the other co-chair, Mary Ann? I'm blanking. Don't we have another co-chair?
We don't have a co-chair.
I thought we had
it's just Barbara.
Just Barbara. Okay. I've obviously blanked out. Barbara Schenkel is the chair of that committee and is also doing a good job at keeping us moving. So thank you to her. Okay, that's our last item. It is now time for the second period we have for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone who would like to come forward? I see someone. Please come forward, sir, and state your name and address.
I'm Richard Bryant at 55 Spurwink Avenue. And the topic that I wanted to bring up to you, I'll try to be very, very brief about this. The planning board is meeting on Tuesday the 18th of July to reconsider its June 20th approval of the Spurwink Woods subdivision. And specifically the issue that's important is the location of the emergency access gate that the planning board approved, which stops the traffic shortcut traffic between Mitchell and Spurwink Road. But rather than locating the gate in the middle of the development and splitting the traffic between Mitchell Highlands neighborhood and the Stevenson neighborhood, the planning board at its last meeting moved the gate from here to here. So essentially all the traffic is now going to come through Stevenson and Spurwink. And I wouldn't ask the council to intrude on the planning board's authority with regard to this, but there are at least two public policy points that the council may want to speak to the planning board about to make sure that they considered the points in their reconsideration. The first point is that because all the traffic is now coming through this intersection, the planning board said we should put a three-way stop sign here on the corner of Stevenson and Spurwink. And the public policy issue is not just how that's going to affect the adjacent property owners, but instead, I think this is the first instance of a stop sign being placed on a major road in Cape Elizabeth other than on an intersection with another major road. I tried to think through all the other possibilities, but I think that's so. And I think the board may want to ask the planning board to think carefully about putting stop signs in on arterials, collectors, or rural connector roads. I think if the gate happened to be relocated back to where we thought it was going to go, that cuts the traffic in half, and probably you don't need a three-way stop sign here on Spurwink. Second public policy issue is that the board's decision requires, as it now stands, requires the developer to form a traffic study of that intersection basically a year after the development. And if necessary, that traffic there makes that intersection unsafe. The developer is supposed to recommend alternatives, which expressly include relocating the gate back to the middle of the road here, middle of the development here, again, splitting the traffic. The issue with that is that the board had made clear that if it was going to have a gate in the middle of the development, they would require sidewalks in the Mitchell Highlands neighborhood. Unfortunately, now with the current form of the approval, if the traffic study says, golly gee, there's too much traffic here, the way to solve it is to put the gate back in the middle, there's nothing in the planning board's approval that will allow them to impose upon the developer the cost of putting the traffic calming in Mitchell Highlands. So effectively, that means if that occurs, it's the town that's going to be on the hook for constructing those sidewalks and stop signs and so forth here. So when the council gave its preliminary approval to the Spurwink Woods Roads and Open Space back in March, I think it was, I know some of the councilors were persuaded by the notion that it's just preliminary approval we're giving, and so this all has to come back before us. But at least with respect to these road issues, the dedication only comes back to you after all of this is constructed. And at that point, it may be too late for the council to effectively address the issue of having the developer deal with this matter here or deal with the stop signs on Spurwink. So I would simply ask the council to take the opportunity to alert the planning board to those two public policy issues and ask the planning board on their in their July 18th meeting to address those issues in their deliberations on the reconsideration.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Councilor Moles?
Speaking of road safety, I did want to thank Councilor Dill for taking on the chairmanship of our new road safety committee, which when is that road safety committee going to meet?
Well, the committee's meeting for the first time on July 24th at 7:30, and at that time we expect to develop a little bit more further what our intention is with respect to committee meetings and getting as much public input as we can. So I'm hopeful that after the July 24th meeting at our August town council meeting, I'll have something to report specifically to members of the public about how they can participate. Well, thank you for bringing that up.
Well, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for volunteering to do that.
Thank you, Councilor Moles, for bringing it up, and Councilor Dill. I'm sure you will do a fine job chairing that and keeping us informed as to what's going on with that. Did you have something else, Mike?
Are you going to mention the upcoming schedule, the Tabor meeting, et cetera, et cetera?
I wasn't planning on it, but it's a good idea. July 28th. I take it back, July 26th, which is a Wednesday, 7 o'clock here.
In this room.
There is a committee being formed, sort of, it's an educational committee of citizens of Cape Elizabeth. The purpose of this group is to inform the citizens of Cape Elizabeth of the impacts if the Tabor referendum is passed, on the state ballot is passed this fall. You do not have to be either pro or against Tabor to be a member of the committee. Anyone who comes to either of the first two meetings will be considered a member of the committee. It will be chaired by Janet McLaughlin. David Backer has asked the two chairs to be Janet McLaughlin and Beth Currier, who have both been very active in town affairs, and I'm sure will do a very good job of running that committee. I urge everyone to be involved in that. It's an important matter for us all within the town and within the state. It could have great impacts on the future of Cape Elizabeth in many ways. And I appreciate you bringing it up, Councilor Moles. So come on down if you're so interested. It's not going to be televised, but because it's just a committee meeting. But the first meeting, again, will be Wednesday, July 26th, here in Town Hall Chambers. So. Are there any other announcements that or things we've forgotten?
I just wanted to thank Lillian Bates for coming in this evening to help with the cable broadcasting. Ryan, as we all know, was no longer with us. And Deb Cabana, who works in cable, is, as we know, no longer with us. And Lillian was good enough to come in and help out, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Great. Thank you very much. Councilors, could we stick around just for a minute to look at our calendars to determine perhaps when we should do that workshop? And we can turn the cameras off.